fascinating speaker. His book, Digging In, just touches on so many aspects of our culture. So it's my honor to introduce you, to Jay Nordlinger.
Thank you so much. I'm very happy to be here in glamorous LA. I saw La La Land, and I immediately wanted to move here. And people said, oh, that's not what it's like. Well, I'd love to move here with just gobs of money and Emma Stone. It just seemed perfect, perfect. But I think the movie was true to life where traffic is concerned. I see every time I come here, which isn't that often, and I love it so. But when I was watching Johnny, I grew up in the Midwest, and when I was watching Johnny Carson in the 70s, I'd stay up late, you know, and maybe early 80s, he'd joke about the traffic in LA. And I thought, well, it's just kind of a joke, you know, it's just a line. But it's true. But it's so glorious to live here that people put up with it, of course. I'm glad this organization exists, and I'm really glad to be invited. And I'm going to talk a bit about what I do. You're supposed to write what you know and talk about what you know. I should know what I do. So if you'll indulge me, I'm a journalist, and it's an interesting life. It may not make you a zillionaire, although it could if you're a certain kind of journalist. But I must say I've enjoyed it. And I was the kind of kid, I'm sure I have this in common with people here, I really like to read the newspaper. You remember we had newspapers. And I loved to read the newspaper with my grandfather on the patio, let's say. And then he'd say we'd solve all the problems of the world. And I liked the world of public affairs. And I liked reading, for some reason when I was a kid, presidential biographies. I just started with Washington and marched through them. I just liked them. And that continued. And when I was in high school, CNN came about. You remember Headline News with Lynn Russell? She was a big deal, believe me. And so I consumed news that way, too. And conservatives like me are supposed to dislike the New York Times a lot. In fact, when I haven't read it in a great many years, but someone once dubbed my column, my web column, Jay Nordlinger Complains About the New York Times. And so all of us on our side do a lot of that. But I must say, I read the New York Times from cover to cover, or the newspaper equivalent, for 20 years, starting when I was in my late teens. And I learned a lot from it, a lot. You know who loved reading the New York Times is Bill Buckley, my old friend and boss. Gave him huge pleasure. He read it his entire life, complained about it, but wrote all of his columns off it. And he once said that going without the New York Times would be going about without arms and legs. I gave up the Times, wrote a little piece about it even, but the one thing I have in common with the late Bob Bork, not legal brilliance, but the last thing, he would not give up in the Times, the obituaries. And I read the obituaries on my phone. I love them. And I don't mean this in a macabre way. I just love the life stories. Sometimes I'm disappointed to learn about people after they're gone, you know, where they've been all my life. And so that I do keep up with. I sometimes feel a little bit guilty about a life in journalism because I read so much journalism and write so much of it. And I read so few books and write so few books. And I sometimes joke, it's a bit of an exaggeration, but it's kind of true, that I read like mad from about 0 to 30. And I haven't read anything since. Because one of my lines is, you can't read and write at the same time. It's got to be one or the other. So I crammed in all this reading. And it's like making deposits into a bank. And then you make withdrawals from your account as the years roll on. Some years ago, maybe 15 years ago, I read an essay by Kenneth Minogue, the Australian-British, I think he was a political scientist, essentially. He was an intellectual. And he wrote a piece based on a speech he'd given called Journalism, Power Without Responsibility. And this quotes Stanley Baldwin, who spoke of journalism as power without responsibility, the prerogative of the harlot through the ages. And he got that line from his cousin, Rudyard Kipling. And what Ken wrote was basically a brief against journalism, against spending too much time reading it or practicing it. And it made a lot of sense to me. And I told him that you know, he'd made me feel bad about what I did. He said, oh, I'm sorry about that. But he didn't take any of it back. I must say I like it. It allows you to be, or might allow you to be, a generalist, to hopscotch around and do a little of everything. My life is typically, so I write several pieces a week and almost always an essay for every issue of National Review. And you're an instant expert, or so-called expert. You do your research, by which I mean, you know, tap at Google for a while, make a few phone calls. And so you're a kind of fake authority for about 3 days. And then it's a lot like Etch-a-Sketch. It's just gone, and you go on to the next thing. But it is good, I think, to be authoritative in some things if you're a generalist. It's like having a college major. To be authoritative in a few things is very, very satisfying. And you ought to be authoritative in your book subjects. And Paul Johnson, the English historian, likes to say, if you really want to find out about something, write a book about it. It's easy for him to say, of course. He's written, I think, between 50 and 60 books. He's up there at Buckley level. But he's right. And I once wrote a history of the Nobel Peace Prize, and a pretty meticulous history. And for a time, I knew, I guess, as much about the Nobel Peace Prize as anyone in the world, including people who worked at the Nobel Foundation. It's almost all gone. I mean, in my head, I mean. And the prize is announced in October. And I'm occasionally called on to give interviews about it. And I really have to read something to refresh myself on what it's all about, because I've gone on to so many other things. A very good way to find out about something is to write a piece of journalism about it. I remember once, years ago, I'd read these charges. I have a bit of an animal rights streak. And I'd read these charges against Kentucky Fried Chicken. We're supposed to call it KFC because fried is bad. But okay. And so I read these charges, and I just wanted to know whether they were true. And I couldn't commission this piece. I had trouble commissioning the piece. And I didn't want to write it, but I did. I looked into it and ate my vegetables, so to speak. So you know, journalism gives you a license to be nosy, to meet people, to go places, to discover things. And I have this current collection called Digging In, which is a compilation divided into several chapters, and it hopscotches around the way I do. And I thought I'd say a little about a few of the pieces and the practice of journalism. And this book starts with a chapter called People, and there are about 15 profiles, I guess, a very diverse cast of characters. And, you know, they're all interesting. I think people are interesting, and Bill Buckley used to quote this line. He didn't come up with it. I don't know who did. 99 of every 100 people are interesting, and so is the 100th, for he is the exception. And I think really everyone has something to say, I've discovered. And I often find that the people who find other people uninteresting really aren't very interesting themselves. Everyone really has something to say, if even about his own experience. And as Rick Burkheiser told me once, you own your own life, you know. And you may be the world's foremost expert on it. And it's important. So sometimes people say, well, how do these pieces come about? How did you contact the person? How did you get the idea? And the answer is it all depends. Sometimes you work at it a little, and sometimes it falls into your lap. And so I have a little of both here. And I just wanted to note a few things. The first piece in this book is about Ivan Castro. It's called Captain Extraordinary, and I read about this fellow in the newspaper. I'm still reading newspapers, I think. He was in our special forces. He'd been in Iraq, and he was horribly injured, including blindness. And he wanted to remain in the special forces to be of some use to others, to the forces. And he did. And he was running marathons and scaling mountains and so on, and I wanted to meet him. And so I put in a request of the Army, and they kind of sloughed it off. And then some people were saying a few months later, you know, we're not really hearing about our heroes in Iraq and Afghanistan the way we have in previous wars. It's such a shame. It must be because of the antipathy of the media or the indifference of the media. And I wrote, I think, a little blog post saying, I don't know, it could be the military itself. I inquired into Ivan Castro. I think that day I got a note saying, would you like to interview him? And I did. And it was very interesting. This next is, it's a long conversation with Jean Genovese, the great historian who went from left to right. I think he was a first Marxist head of the American Historical Association. Then he became quite a conservative, brilliant fellow, fascinating. And I asked to see him, and this may be slightly macabre, but I wanted to see him while I still could. And I did. And this is a piece called Uber Survivor. I do some work in Salzburg every summer, and a friend of mine there died, and I had the responsibility of attending his funeral. And there was a man, the head of the local Jewish community, such as it is, speaking. And an acquaintance of mine said, that man is 100 years old. And I didn't know who he was pointing to, because the speaker looked up to be about 80 tops, mid-70s maybe. No, that man's 100 years old, and he survived every camp you've ever heard of, and he likes to say, I could write a Michelin guide to the camps. His name is Marco Feingold, and he was that year, 2013, 100. I believe he's still going. And I went to see him, and sharp as a tack, remembered everything. And this is a man born in 1913 who had vivid memories of World War I. I don't mean the sort of thing, I gauzily remember my parents. No. He actually remembered very specific things about World War I, even. There's a piece here about a Moroccan journalist, a woman named Razoui. And she worked for Charlie Hebdo, sorry. And she was absent the day of the massacre. And I met her at the Oslo Freedom Forum. And she told me everything, and she was very candid. And of course, there's a bounty on her head. There are a lot of people who want to kill her because she's an affront to them. She's a woman. She's anti-jihadist, certainly. She worked for this magazine. And at the end, I said to her, I told her how much I admired her. And I said, if you'll forgive me for saying this, I hope you die an old lady in bed. And she said, for that, I'll have to quit smoking. This is a great spirit, a great, great spirit. So one of the richest men in America, and I think the leading oilman in America, is a man named Harold Hamm. He's an Oklahoman, but he's the number one guy in the North Dakota oil boom. And he is the 13th and last child of cotton sharecroppers. And I sometimes catch myself saying poor cotton sharecroppers, but you know, it's not like they're rich cotton sharecroppers. And he was the 13th and last child, utterly self-made, a real Horatio Alger story. And I learned about him when I was covering the oil boom in North Dakota. And I learned about that. There's a piece on that, too, in this book, in a chapter called America, Some Snapshots. Fascinating story, the North Dakota oil boom. Lowest unemployment rate in the nation, highest growth, people from all over going there to work, sort of a new gold rush. One of my favorite stories is that one day at noon, McDonald's ran out of food. Walmart couldn't hire people. They were making too much in the oil patch. Strippers were coming from Vegas. It was quite a scene. I read that Julie Kent, the prima ballerina with the American Ballet Theater, was retiring. And I thought, oh, there's a peg, an excuse. I, of course, just wanted to meet her because, like everyone else, I'd been in love with her for years. And I interviewed her on the occasion of her retirement. And it was a most enchanting hour. And I sort of floated away, you know. But the truth is, I requested to interview her because I wanted to meet her. It resulted in an interesting piece about the ballet life. But one neat thing about this job is that if you want to interview someone, if you want to meet someone, maybe you can. And I am so arrogant that I'm actually offended now when they say no. Just the other, I caught myself, I was surprised at myself. About a month ago, I wanted to interview Israel Kirzner, a famous economist, a free marketeer from NYU. I studied with Mises there in New York. He's in his late 80s. He's a rabbi in Brooklyn. I figure, you know, what does he have to do? Surely he'd love me to come around and turn on my tape recorder. He said, no, thank you. I was all offended. I thought, I said, gee, that's so strange. You're so spoiled. But, you know, man has a right not to be interviewed. He didn't want to. But a great many say yes. So in America, some snapshots. There's a piece about Maine, the state of Maine. I met a guy at a luncheon in Houston. And, you know, where are you from? He said, Maine. That's not necessarily every day. I said, you know, what was it like growing up there? It was great. He said, now, however, Maine's always had problems. It's always been poor and alcoholic, like most cold places in the world. But now it is like the worst of Appalachia. It is desperate, the state of Maine, with drugs and suicide and prostitution and the worst of it. What was that? Well, I'll give you a funny line. Sort of a funny, ghoulish line. There are Somalian gangs in some Maine towns, and a resident of Maine cracked me about the only trouble we didn't have was racial trouble, and we had to import it. And so now they have it. Yeah. So I have a snapshot of Maine. I have a prison program in Houston. That's why I was in Houston, this kind of miraculous thing. It's part of Chuck Colson's prison fellowship. And these inmates, they have a business plan expo, if you can believe it, a business plan competition. They draw plans for the businesses they're going to start when they're on the outside. And this is judged by local businessmen. It's a competition. And they take it very seriously. And some of the ideas are so good, the judges invest. And so I went to look into that. And here was something really strange. Is a piece called Blowing Up Barbie. Someone told me that there is a summer camp for explosives, for learning how to use explosives, for high school students. I thought, in America? In our bubble-wrapped society where kids on tricycles have football helmets? There's a camp for explosives? And there is. There really is. It's in Rolla, Missouri, at the former Missouri School of Mines. It's now the Missouri University of Science and Technology, and lo and behold, they blow stuff up. And they blew up a Barbie doll while I was there. And there are these campers, instantly lovely girls, you know, girlish girls, putting their shells together at picnic tables. And I said to one of the counselors, it looks like arts and crafts. And she said, yeah, but arts and crafts with an edge. And I thought, and so that was something new under the sun. Pardon? I'm impressed.
Wow.
I'm impressed.
What did she say?
It's for avalanche.
Oh, for avalanche.
Teach you how to explode mountains to prevent avalanches. The whole school is at Mount Baldy.
It's important knowledge to have. Absolutely.
Are there any Muslims in that school?
They don't ski. Yes.
Someone told me that there was this classical liberal university in Guatemala that has Adam Smith Plaza and Ludwig von Mises Library and the Milton Friedman Auditorium. I said, no way. He said, way. I said, no way. He said, way. No way, no way, no way. And it's one of the leading schools in all of Latin America. It's called the Francisco Marroquin University in Guatemala City. I had to see it with my own eyes. It's really true. And I call it a unicorn of a university. So there's a long chapter in this book called Issues and Essays. And I'm sure I got this heading from the old TV news program, Issues and Answers. And there's everything from A to Z in this. And I've noted a few. The first one I wrote early in Obama's first term. It's called Hail to the Golfer in Chief. It's defense of Obama and his golf habit, because he was really getting it from both left and right. He was getting it from the left because golf was sort of Republican and corporate and white. And he was getting it from the right because he was spending too much time on the golf course away from work, which was fine with me. And so I made a little essay about it. And here's one called Books and Covers. Do you remember that strange ad around Christmas time with that young man in that plaid onesie? And it was talk to your parents about health care, and people nicknamed him Pajama Boy. And they said that he, quote, looked liberal. And I thought, what is it to look liberal? What is it to look like your politics? And so an essay came tumbling out. And the truth is, sometimes you do and sometimes you don't. Sometimes you can judge a book by its cover and sometimes you can't. And it's kind of interesting. I have one called The Even Steven Temptation. It's something I've been familiar with my whole life. Do you remember when Obama at that prayer breakfast said that we shouldn't be on our high horse about the jihad because we had the Crusades and the Inquisition and Jim Crow and all that stuff? And I'm very familiar with this from my hometown of Ann Arbor, Michigan, which I call a small citadel of the left. So in those days, for example, if you complained about the gulag, they would say, well, what about Japanese internment? And if you said, well, what about poets in Castro's Cuba? Well, what about the Hollywood 10? So it was Even Steven, you see. And so off I went. This is a personal essay. It's called A Long Way from Harlan County. It's about me and labor unions. I'll tell you how it came about. I was to fly, like hundreds of others, to the Oslo Freedom Forum, the annual human rights gathering in Norway, which is where I met this Moroccan journalist. And at the last second, it was canceled owing to a hotel strike. All these people couldn't come in for this rather important event because of this hotel strike. And there's something I learned ages ago from Fred Barnes, for whom I worked at the Weekly Standard many years ago. And when he was just starting out, an editor told him this story. A young reporter was supposed to cover a divorce trial. That really dates it, doesn't it? And he came back and said, I'm so sorry, there's no story. Today's session was canceled. And his boss said, that is the story. That it was canceled. And the young man said, oh, of course. So I was kind of ticked not to be able to go to this event. And earlier that year, or that music season, opening night of Carnegie Hall was canceled. It was shut down because of a strike by the Stagehands Union. Now, so the Philadelphia Orchestra was to play, and I think there was a chorus and soloists and all the audience and all the patrons and gala dinner. This Stagehands Union has 5 members, and their action canceled opening night at Carnegie Hall, the most prestigious concert hall in America. Now, mind you, these are not horny-handed sons of toil. The chief of them, at that time, I think it was about 4 years ago, made $530K, and all the others made above $400. We're not talking about Harlan County miners coughing up soot. You see what I mean? So I wrote this essay because I have always wanted to be pro-union, pro-labor. My problem was I was born too late. And they've always been unreasonable, you know, from my point of view. And I've never wanted to be, I mean, who wants to be pro-management? You know, that's like rooting for the New England Patriots in the Super Bowl or something. You know, they always win.
Yay!
Yeah.
Can't
say anything bad about Tom Brady. Really, he is the best. He is the best. Yeah, yeah. So I wrote this essay about labor unions. I'll give you another one. I was reading something online, and this guy said, anthropology is the lamest major whose name doesn't have the word studies in it. Now, you remember the old line, I resemble that remark? I majored in anthropology. So, well, I'll tell you something about studies. I was once interviewing Jeb Bush, and I raised the fact that he, at the University of Texas, he majored in Latin American studies. And I said, isn't that kind of a lefty major? And he said, yeah, well, isn't anything studies? And it's just so true. But anthropology was once a great field that a lot of bright kids majored in, like Saul Bellow, for example. But it had a terrible decline when it was captured by not just the left, but the flaky left. And so I wrote a piece called Majoring in Anthro, a lament for a once great and inherently great discipline, and so on. So the next chapter is about language. I write a lot about language. I don't know why. I like it. And the truth is, I think, you know, some people like butterflies and postage stamps or tennis. I like words and sounds. Don't know why. I just do. So I write a lot about various aspects of language. And the first one is about Americans and foreign languages. And it was occasioned by Barack Obama's saying that Americans are dopes because we don't learn foreign languages. And so that prompted an essay from me about the learning of foreign languages in various societies. You may remember Obama was giving a speech at the UN, and he kept referring to the head Iranian as the supreme leader. And this sparked for me an essay about how we address or refer to dictators, tyrants, and so on. You remember the Dear Comandante letters from the 1980s sent to Daniel Ortega? I love what Stephen Solar said, the Democratic, I think it was chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, or the House Foreign Affairs Committee. I remember saying on television, that's his title. But it's kind of an interesting topic. Joe Biden, several times when he was vice president, referred to the president in public as Barack. Very, very rare, the first naming of a president. Very rare. And I think he did it to suggest intimacy, or maybe his power, or his view that maybe he was older and wiser. I don't know. But not so much here in America anymore, but other places in the world, first naming is a very, very tricky business. So I told stories about that. Here in America, we're all first names, right? Elsewhere, it can be a little bit tricky. There's an editorial in the New York Times about the Supreme Court. It referred to 5 conservatives and 4 moderate liberals. I thought, well, that's kind of interesting. So that led to an essay on labeling in politics. Here's a piece called Adventures in Lexical Fashion. It was Christmas time. I was in the little village of Greenport, Long Island. My niece was in a little choir singing on the green, very traditional, very American, Norman Rockwell-esque. And they started singing Deck the Halls. And I thought, oh my gosh, what are they going to do about Don We Now Our Gay Apparel? Now, what word are they going to substitute? It was a whole new lyric. It was Baudelaireized. So this prompted, my fingers itched to write. I wrote an essay about words, words related to homosexuality and how they've evolved. And this led to race and ethnicity, and also to the disabled. Very interesting history. You know, we used to have in this country homes for idiots. And it was a loving, progressive word. It implied an individuality. Think of idiosyncrasy, for example. And then the progressive, cutting-edge PC word was retarded, which is now verboten. Retarded meant delayed, late. It was the cutting-edge PC word, and it eventually became a slur. And then I think we had the handicapped, and that was bad. It was handicapable. Disabled, differently abled. I don't know what the current word is, but it's a very interesting history.
Children with disabilities.
Yeah. And I'll tell you this one, too. I met a man a couple of months ago, a wonderful man named Jerry Horton, who with his wife in Texas founded a ranch for disabled adults, including their own daughter. And this fellow had had polio as a child, and he's from San Jose. And he was cured, or at least helped, in San Francisco at the Shriners Hospital for Crippled Children. That was the official name of it. And one of my points is the people who worked in that hospital were probably the most loving people around. But it's a language issue. Here's one on the use and abuse of the word establishment called the E word. There was a time, I think it was in 2012, and all of a sudden establishment was in every other sentence. So I traced this word and its use and abuse. Here's one called the Z word about Zionism and Zionist. Nobody knows what Zionism is, or so few now. Zionist is just a ridiculous slur. But it really ought to mean someone who believes in a Jewish homeland in the Middle East. Simple as that. So I get into that. And you know the phrase, the right side of history? Oh, the right side of history, the wrong side of history. I have an essay about that. I was listening to a guy I admire quite a bit today, just an hour ago, an hour and a half ago, on the internet, Mike Pompeo, the new director of the CIA, who gave a wonderful statement about Julian Assange and WikiLeaks and Edward Snowden. But he did use that phrase, the right side of history. I forgave him. But this is such a bogus phrase. And as Robert Conquest, the late historian, said to me, it has a Marxist twang. Richard Pipes said, history doesn't have sides, but historians do. Sort of interesting. And I end with a chapter on music. I'm a music critic at night. I kind of have a day job and a night job, political journalist in the day, later a music critic. There's no music criticism in this chapter. There are essays and profiles. And the first one is about Lee Hoiby, the late American composer, especially of songs. He was always one of my favorite songwriters, and I got to know him. And this unusual friendship developed between us. We were very, very different. In many respects, and alike in others. He actually dedicated a song to me, which was so unexpected. And then right after him is a very different composer, Elliot Carter, a high priest of modernism. Lee Hoiby was a neo-romantic, tonalist composer. And it was Carter's 100th birthday. And his publisher wrote and said, would you like to interview Mr. Carter on the occasion of his 100th birthday? And I had knocked Carter in my criticism for years. And I thought, well, don't they know who I am? But anyway, I said, sure, I'd love to meet him. And he was in his apartment in Greenwich Village, where he lived for a very, very long time, came to the door to let me in, 100 years old, was reading a volume of Meyer Shapiro on philosophy of art. He's really one of the most intelligent people I've ever been around. I'm not a great admirer of his music necessarily, although it's intellectually brilliant, but I'm an admirer of his personally. Do you remember the second Obama inauguration when Beyonce lip-synced the national anthem? This led to an essay by me called Faking It and Making It, about that kind of thing in music, and what's legit and what's not, and all that stuff. So, I have a couple more remarks, if you can bear them. What are those remarks? I'll tell you in a second. All the polished speakers do just what I'm doing right now. There's an expression, it's fish wrap by Friday. Mark Helprin, who writes enduring novels, had a column in the Wall Street Journal. He's so anti-journalism, or he's so... It's not anti-journalism. He has a certain skepticism. He headed his column, Written on Water. Think of that. What an image, written on water. Phew. Away it goes. But there's some journalism that deserves to be preserved. And I tell you, I'm in no way comparing myself, I promise you. But I had occasion, for reasons I could explain, to read a collection of journalism by John Dos Passos about half a year ago. And he wrote for National Review in his later years. And he wrote famous novels, in particular the USA trilogy. But this collection of journalism was stunning, a stunning book, and I'm so glad it existed. And there is some journalism that has legs, that is not so ephemeral. I remember long ago, must have been 2000, because Bill Bradley was running for president for the Democratic nomination against Al Gore. And I was writing about Bradley, and I looked at an old piece by Rick Brookhiser. Terrific thing. And I thought, I'm the only person who's ever going to read this thing till the end of time. I'd especially read it. And it's sort of a shame. And I read a piece by Christopher Hitchens in Vanity Fair about Vikram Seth, about whom I was the Anglo-Indian novelist. And it was just great. And I thought, maybe no one will ever read this again unless it's anthologized. And I doubt it will be. But that's the nature of this business. I say we're in a funny era for journalism on both left and right and in the center. And it seems to me that more and more journalists are being treated like politicians. And it's largely the journalist's fault, I think, because often they act like politicians. For example, I'll see journalists on platforms delivering applause lines. You can say, I have no applause lines, as you can see. And I even said to a couple of my colleagues, are you running for office? It was sort of red meat from journalists. And someone said to me on Twitter not long ago, I had tweeted something. He said, do you know that you've offended millions of voters? Yeah. I'm not running for office. I'm not appealing for your vote. But these lines are getting blurred. And I'm an offender in this regard. I've had my forays into politics, my dabblings. I took a leave of absence from National Review in the year 2000 at the end of that campaign to help George W. Bush. And I dabbled with Ted Cruz as an old friend of mine. But, you know, Joe Transparency, disclosing all the way. So I'm really not one to talk because I live in a glassy house. But I think the blending of journalism and politics is maybe not all that great. You know, everyone is a partisan or seen as a partisan. And sometimes you say something just because you think it's true. And I tell you, someone I've come to admire quite a bit. And there's a lot of punch pulling in journalism, including in me. I pull, if I may say so, patting myself on the back, many fewer punches than others. But I still pull them in both politics and music. And I know when I do it. Oh, what will the audience think? Oh, what will the repercussions be? But bless those journalists who write without thought to the repercussions. And a person I've come to admire quite a bit, which is kind of a dumb thing to say, because I've admired him since I was a kid, practically, but I'm speaking of George Will, who's now in his mid-70s, who just doesn't care. Now, what do I mean by that? He doesn't care what the left thinks. He doesn't care what the right thinks. He just doesn't care. He writes what he thinks is true. And he may think that's fairly common, but please trust me, because I'm in the business. I know the business here, right? It's the film world. But in my little world, I'm in the business. Trust me, it is very, very rare. George Will don't give a damn, really. He doesn't care what you think. He writes what he thinks is true. This is very, very, very rare. And I spend a lot of time covering what Bob Conquist called non-consensual societies, dictatorships, tyrannies, authoritarian situations. And I know some journalists under dictatorship. I know of a great many more. I've interviewed many of them. And the things they risk, censorship, imprisonment, torture, murder. And I think, you know, I might be scared of a few mean tweets or letters to the editor. So, Jay, don't be such a marshmallow, for God's sakes. But it's funny how that comes about. So if you can find an honest journalist, even one who's willing to tick you off, I say cling to him as we do to our guns and religion. So I'm going to be quiet now and ask for questions and comments. So thank you very much. Thank you.